Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Unidos US, I would like to welcome everyone to today's call. Unidos US is the nation's largest Latino civil rights and advocacy organization in the nation. And we have an office in Los Angeles and 68 affiliate community-based organizations across the state. Today's poll was conducted by BSP Research, and it is the first of its kind. And it's the first that's going to be taking place during the 2024 cycle. Also joining us today is Mi Familia Vota, with whom we are partnering in the multi-year, multi-state effort to grow Latino participation and advance the community's priorities. But before we get into the poll's results, I want to take a moment to plug our new data website. We just released the first of its kind Hispanic electorate data hub. The hub provides data on the size and the growth of the Latino electorate over the last two decades, with dynamic multi-cycle polling results and a chart of 2024 competitive districts with Hispanic voter influence. Today's new polling research is an important element of our data hub, which aims to advance an accurate understanding of Hispanic voters and build on Unidos US's policy and program experience. Over the last two decades, we have registered nearly 1 million Latinos. And in the past two election cycles, we have reached over 500,000 voters in our Get Out the Vote activities. We know that meaningful outreach works, and that voter registration continues to be one of the greatest opportunities and areas for needed investment in our community. And now with that, I would like to introduce Gary Segura from BSP, who's going to walk us through the California poll results. Gary?
Thank you, Esmeralda, and greetings to my fellow Californians. Good morning. I'm here to talk about California's portion of a national poll that BSP was proud to conduct for Unidos US, and I'm going to share my screen. Let's all keep our fingers crossed that this works as intended. Let's see. Hopefully you're all seeing a white box. If someone could give me a thumbs up, that'd be great.
You're good, Gary.
Thank you. Okay, so the Unidos US 2024 one-year out survey. This was a survey of Latino voters nationwide with oversamples in key states, including California. And so I'll be going through the results that are California specific. Okay, we interviewed 3,037 Latino eligible voters. Most of those were current registered voters. And we had a small side sample of 330 eligible but not yet registered. The margin of error nationally was plus or minus 1.8%. We plussed up to make sure we had 300 per in California and a number of other states. And the margin of error on the California result are plus or minus 5.7%. We fielded the first 2 weeks of November in English and Spanish, online and telephone. And the English and Spanish was chosen at the respondents' request at the moment of first contact to make sure we had retained a representative sample. Now, there are a number of key findings in California. The first is that California Latinos' top issues are consistent with the Latinos in other parts of the country. So the top five issues were overwhelmingly inflation, jobs in the economy, healthcare, affordable housing, and crime and gun violence. Immigration ranks sixth. We're going to come to that in just a moment. When we asked people about the economy and specifically about inflation, food and basic necessities, housing and rent, gasoline and health insurance were the principal concerns people told us when they were talking about cost of living concerns. When we asked about jobs in the economy, overwhelmingly it was a need for better pay in the jobs that they had and the better benefits in terms of vacation, healthcare, and so forth. For healthcare, the overwhelming concern was the cost of health insurance and the cost of prescription drugs. The second main finding we want to talk about is immigration, which ranks sixth as the priority issue in California and nationally. Providing a path to citizenship for Dreamers and other immigrants with longstanding ties in the country are two of the major political desires of Latino registered voters. California Latinos also want to see protections against deportation and expanded pathways for legal immigration. Third, concern about the climate was very high among the Latino sample in California and elsewhere. Latinos think action is urgently needed to forestall weather and climate-related catastrophes. Only about 6% of California Latinos could be called climate deniers. Fourth, Latino voters consistently saw Democrats as better aligned with their values and views on a host of issues, including treating people with dignity and respect, preservation of democracy in elections, healthcare, and election security. Yet many Latino voters don't feel that either party truly cares about the Latino community, and I'll talk about that in specifics. Looking forward to the 2024 election, President Biden holds a substantial polling lead among Latino voters in California, while the U.S. Senate race remains competitive at this very early stage. Democratic representatives Katie Porter, Barbara Lee, and Adam Schiff are the top three candidates, each with an equal percentage of Latino support in a very, very tight Senate primary. President Biden's approval rating stands at 50%, and in the potential 2024 matchups, he holds a 21-point lead over President Trump and a 33-point lead over Governor DeSantis. In 2024, 23% of Latinos in California will be voting in their first presidential election. This is really remarkable. 16% will be voting in their first federal election of any kind, while another 7% voted in 2022 for the first time. Another 17% voted in their first presidential election in 2020. What that means is that going into the 24 election, 41% of California's Latino electorate is new to the electorate since Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton faced off in 2016. It's a hugely new electorate. So we want to talk a little bit about the priorities and policy views of Latino voters. Now, recall we asked Latino voters to tell us what the three issues that were most important to them were, and they could pick any three from a long list or offer one that we would then categorize in a list. And overwhelmingly, inflation and the cost of living was the number one choice. 53% of our respondents chose this as one of their three issues. 44% said jobs and the economy. 31% said healthcare, 30% said lack of affordable housing or cost of rent, and 29% said crime and gun violence. As you can see, immigration is lower than it has historically been among Latino voters, in part because of the relatively lower rates of immigration of Latinos in the last decade. And then you can see the rest going down all the way to police reform and so forth. So overwhelmingly, the major issues that Latinos are concerned about in California are the same as they are in the rest of the country, and they mirror that of the rest of the population. We asked which party would be best at addressing your number one concern. So not the top three, but the number one. And in California overall, 41% said the Democrats were best at addressing their number one concern. 38% of men, 43% of women. It's interesting. Only among older voters, 40 plus, do we even reach the 50% mark. Now, overwhelmingly, Democrats are preferred to Republicans, but both and neither together are more than a third of the electorate in each category, suggesting that there's some uncertainty. There's some weak commitment to trusting political parties. What did you have in mind? Okay, so this is important. So when we had people tell us that inflation was their most important concern or jobs was their most important concern, we followed up. We asked them, well, what about that? When we said, what did you have in mind when you said inflation and the rising cost of living were important issues? Again, people could check all that apply. 77% of our respondents said buying or renting a place to live is too high. That is different than in the rest of the United States. In the rest of the United States, food and basic living expenses were 76. That was the number one answer. But in California, the cost of housing is the number one answer. 67% said gasoline, 44% said health, 37% said child rearing expenses, and 16% referred to running a small business. So overwhelmingly, housing is a major concern in California. What did you have in mind if you said jobs and the economy is your most important concern? The number one answer is jobs don't pay enough, or I have to take a second job in order to make ends meet. 42% said the job does not provide benefits like paid leave and sick days. 41% are worried about layoffs. 35% are worried about having to pick up extra shifts because there aren't enough workers hired at their place of business. 21% are concerned about safety, 21% about hours, and only 5% mentioned anything else. What did you have in mind when you said healthcare was your concern? As I indicated at the top of the presentation, 58% were concerned about healthcare costs and 47% were concerned about medication costs. 46% are concerned about the quality of healthcare providers and facilities. In other work we've done, this is not surprising. There is definitely a shortage of physicians in California and a serious shortage of physicians and nurses who are able to provide those skills to Hispanic families. Thinking about the U.S. immigration system, which of the following do you think are the most important issues? Now, this is a check all that apply, but unlike the others, we didn't ask this just of people who identified immigration. We asked this of everyone. And according to everyone, the number one thing they're concerned about in immigration is a path to citizenship for dreamers. The number two thing is the path to citizenship for long-term residents who are undocumented. Number three is reforming asylum. Number four is increasing legal immigration. Number five is protecting Latinos from deportation. Number six is providing support for communities who receive asylum seekers. Tied for six is increased border security, 27%. It's far behind paths to citizenship for long-term residents. Finish the wall, 20%, and deport everyone. The most draconian position is a 13% position. Which policies do you think would be the best solutions to make your schools safer for students and teachers? 57% said mental health and counseling, and 48% said gun reform, and 44% said secure entry. Only 12% favor arming teachers. Do you agree or disagree with the following statement? No matter what my personal beliefs about abortion are, I think it is wrong to make abortion illegal and to take that choice away from everyone else. 74% of Californians and 71% of Latinos nationwide agree with the statement that it's wrong to take away choice. This is an incredibly important finding and one that's really important to dispelling myths and beliefs about the Latino community. The Latino community was never as anti-abortion, anti-choice as caricatures would make it out to be. They were slightly more conservative than whites on this issue, but that is no longer the case. Support for choice among Latinos is extraordinarily high. It's high among men, women, young voters, older voters, Catholics, even moderates and self-identified conservatives agree that it's wrong to take away choice on reproductive health. When it comes to climate change, which of these statements do you agree? And we allowed only two selections here, so we could really get some segmentation on what people believed. 46% said climate change is a serious problem that affects people's lives. 37% says it's causing extreme weather events that are also putting people at risk. 28% says it's displacing people. Only 22% say that is real, but we can't do anything about it. 19% say it's real, but not an emergency. And as I reported at the top, only 6% of Latinos in California are climate deniers. Candidates and parties, we mentioned this at the top. Thinking about the election coming up in November of this coming year, which party do you think would do a better job of handling the issues? The Democrats lead the Republicans on each of these issues: Medicaid, voting rights, abortion, immigration, gun safety, and school shootings, classroom and teaching curriculum, overwhelmingly. However, just as we found earlier, a third or even slightly more than a third of the voters say both or neither. So the tilt in the Democratic favor is large, but there's a large middle of people who hold neither party or both parties as equally likely to return what they're asking for in the policy regime. When we asked what you're looking for in a candidate, what traits do you admire in a candidate? 92%, again, people could check all that apply. 92% want a candidate that brings people together. 91% said, I want someone to fight for my priorities, but they must be willing to compromise to get things done. 88% said realistic policy ideas, 85% said prior experience in elected office, 83% said bolder ideas, 77% supported by Latino organizations, business experience at 76%. Law enforcement, unions, those are somewhat lower in the priority, though still positively impacting on the choice of candidate. Curiously, speak Spanish, 60%, and supported by businesses, corporations, 60%, and being Hispanic and Latino, 46%. Those numbers are lower than we find, are higher rather, than we find in other parts of the country for the speaking Spanish and being Hispanic or Latino, but they're not overwhelming. Latinos are policy voters, not simply identity voters. Generally speaking, which party do you believe shares your values or is closer to your personal beliefs on each of these issue dimensions? Again, Democrats lead Republicans on every issue, but there is a large undecided or neither both category. The only category on which Democrats exceed 50% is equality and treating all people with respect and dignity. 53% said the Democrats share their values, only 18% said Republicans. We asked about white supremacy because hate speech has been a big part of the political environment these last several years. For how many of you think it's important, or do you think it's personally important for elected officials and other leaders to speak out against hate speech, white nationalism, and white supremacy? 83% of Californians said it was somewhat or very important. 80% of men, 86% of women, every category of person, whether it's language communities, ideologies, age groups, everyone thinks that leaders should speak out against white supremacy and hate speech. Here are comparisons of the two political parties. This is the Democratic slide, just so you know, there'll be a Republican slide coming up. So we asked, thinking about national politics, would you say that the Democratic Party cares a great deal, doesn't care too much, or is being hostile towards the Latino community? In California, 52% of our respondents think that the Democratic Party cares a great deal about the Latino community. 39% are a little bit more cautious, says the Democratic Party doesn't care too much. Only 10% say that the Democratic Party is hostile. That should be compared to the response to the Republican Party. 30% of California Latinos believe the Republican Party is hostile to their interests, and 49% say they don't care too much. Only 21% of California Latinos think that Republicans care a great deal, and that number is contrasted with the 52% on Democrats. As you can see, it varies a bit by ideology, and it varies a bit across different language groups and so forth, but the results are fairly consistent. And the same is true for the Republican Party. Okay, let's talk about how feelings have changed, because there's been an awful lot of reportage about shifts in the Latino community to the right. When we asked, over the past few years, would you say you've become more open to supporting Republicans than in the past, more open to supporting Democrats in the past, or that your views haven't changed much? In California, 38% describe themselves as more open to Democrats, 19% describe themselves as more open to Republicans, and what's true in California is true everywhere else in the country. The vast majority of people report no change at all, okay? So that's fairly small. These shifts really undermine the claim that there's a dramatic shift to the right among Republicans, among Latinos towards Republicans. However, I think it is fair to say that Republicans are on average doing better among Latino electorates, and it feels a little bit more like a regression to the mean. It was very common, certainly prior to the 90s, and actually prior to through the mid-2000s, for the Republican Party to get about a third of the Latino vote. And so what we observed in the Obama elections and in the first Hillary election was really atypical to see 70% plus voting Democratic. It's normally been about two-thirds, one-third. Looking ahead, who would you vote for in the upcoming all-candidate primary? And as you can see, the Democrats are dominating the Republicans, but the Democrats are not dominating one another, with 18% for Porter, 16% for Lee, 16% for Schiff, 11% for former baseball star Steve Garvey, and 8% for Republican James Bradley. I think that's a pretty good position for the Democrats to be in here. It doesn't suggest that there's likely to be a GOP candidate to reach the runoff, so you could have a Democratic lockout on that top two process. In the 2024 election for president, if it was today, are you leaning towards voting for Democrat Joe Biden or Republican Trump or DeSantis, depending on, we did both. In a Biden-Trump matchup, Biden leads by 21 points among Latinos in California. In a Biden-DeSantis matchup, Biden leads by 33 points in California. But it is not overwhelming. You're talking about 53-56% of the vote. If you distributed that 15% in the Biden-Trump outcome, you would end up getting about 61 to 38 or so, which would not be a resounding victory for the president in California. So there is softness. If you're a GOP activist, there is softness and support for the Democratic candidate. Do you approve or disapprove of the way Biden is handling his job as president of the United States? 50% approve, 41% disapprove, and therein lies the rub about why those numbers are pretty soft. We also have it broken out, and obviously you'll have a chance to see that. As you know, there'll be an election later this year for offices such as president, U.S. Congress, and many state and local offices. How likely are you to vote? 54% said that they are almost certain to vote. Another 17% say probably. 71 is a very good number for Latinos to be at this far out. Remember, there's almost no outreach to Latinos by candidates or parties. They only come from civil society, like organizations like Unidos US and others. But nevertheless, even in the absence of electoral outreach on the part of candidates and parties, you have 71% thinking that they probably or certainly will vote. And that's a good place to start for Latino mobilization. I'm going to stop there and turn it back over to Esmeralda. And I want to thank you for your attention. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Gary. Today's poll showed that Latino voters in California have really remained consistent in their concerns about the rising cost of living, jobs, and healthcare. I did want to highlight something that was new and notable. And then that's that according to the poll, the rising cost of housing is now a top five concern for Latino voters. The results of this poll are not surprising for many Californians. The impacts of inflation, healthcare, and of course the cost of housing rising have been felt by us on a daily basis. However, it is important to note that there is a disproportionate impact on the Latino community. For example, according to our research as Unidos, we found that 52% of Latino households in the state of California did not earn enough to meet their basic needs. And that's compared to 33% of overall Californians. Regardless if you live in the Bay Area, LA, or the Central Valley, housing costs have pushed out people to surrounding areas, increasing commutes and decreasing quality of life. When it comes to home ownership, the poll indicated that the top barrier that was identified by Latino voters is the lack of affordable homes, followed by low income levels, and then a lack of personal savings. Our recently published report, Building California's Future, shows that Latino home ownership rate in 2021 was 18 percentage points lower than that of non-Hispanic white population. While it's good to see that there have been some investments made here in the state of California, decades of underproduction cannot be remedied without more significant investments. And what this poll indicates is that the Latino community needs meaningful progress to lower the cost of living because we are disproportionately affected. Other issues of note that we have found also through our research and work on the ground as Unidos US that were validated in this poll is that Latino voters are concerned about college affordability and student loans, as well as supporting students who fell behind during the pandemic. As Gary shared, overall, Latino voters think that Democrats would better than Republic were better than Republicans at handling nearly any of their top priorities. However, this poll should still serve as a wake-up call for elected officials for the need for more Latino voter engagement. Latinos, who are the second largest voting age group in the state of California, indicate only 52% of them indicated in this poll that they're 100% likely to vote in the November election. Latino voters cannot be taken for granted. The concerns of Latino voters in California are dominated by economic and pocketbook issues. Latinos want to see policy solutions and financial investments that make the most impact on their daily lives. Meaningful engagement of Latino voters should matter to any American and, of course, Californians who want to see an economy that works for everyone, communities with less gun violence, and an improved humane immigration system. As the state's second largest voting bloc, we cannot be taken for granted. Beyond engagement that's meaningful and begins early, changes that impact our most pressing concerns should be a bigger priority for elected officials. Latino voters have been responsible for deciding numerous elections, and 2024 will be no different. Thank you. And now I'm going to pass it over to Tim Hernandez from Mi Familia Vota.
Thank you for that, Esmeralda. Hello, everyone. My name is Tim Hernandez. I'm the California State Director with Mi Familia Vota. The item that I take away from this poll is one of the items that Gary highlighted himself, of 41% of California's Latino electorate being new since Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump faced off in 2016. From our perspective, this is a tremendous moment to engage the new electorate, and this poll provides a blueprint for doing just that. By discussing the Latino community's policy priorities and civic engagement campaigns, we plan to leverage this poll and its findings in our direct community engagement. Our community faces rising costs of living. And in that, I also noticed that there was multiple moments where we have rising costs of housing appear again and again in both the idea of why we voted for inflation and the idea of why we see the rising cost of living as a higher item there in our poll. But additionally, they feel like their voices aren't being heard. In turn, as the organization with the most extensive field infrastructure targeting Latinos in the country, Mi Familia Vota is committed to building Latino political power by expanding that electorate further and strengthening local infrastructures and really executing year-round voter engagement programs. We know that for California to prosper, our community must thrive, engage, and vote. By staying true to the community's needs, we will ensure they're registered and civically educated, using their voice to the fullest, and really have the tools they need to hold politicians accountable to their and our policy priorities in November. With that said, I will turn it over for questions from the larger group.
Hey everyone, as a reminder, you can type your questions in the chat box or in the Q&A box at the bottom, or you can click the raise hand button and ask your question out loud. We just ask if you could please say your name and your outlet when you're asking a question. We'll give everybody a couple moments here to type or raise their hand. We have a question in from Joe Garofoli from the San Francisco Chronicle. This question's for Gary. A lot of the battleground House races in California were decided by a few votes in 2022. Two questions. How much do you think Latino voter turnout will change in the 2024 general and March 5th primary, if you have, in these races? Two, what one or two issues will Latino voters be making their choice on in the Central Valley and OC LA House races?
First, hi, Joe. We haven't talked in a while. So I think the turnout will be higher in 24 than it was in 22. That's always true in the presidential midterm offset. Presidential elections just simply attract more people to the polls. That should make this harder for the Republican incumbents to hold those seats than it was in 2022. In terms of what Hispanic and Latino voters are going to be thinking about when they walk in there, according to our poll today, they're going to be thinking a lot about the economy, but of course that's kind of baked in at that point. And so then the question is, what's going to be on their mind? I think you're going to see lots of efforts to tie Republican incumbents to the apparent standard bearer of the party, a lot of effort to to tie it to the chaos that went on in the House of Representatives, which is not a popular institution right now, particularly among Latinos. And then there's also the issue of the disappearance of Kevin McCarthy's money, which I think may in fact make it harder for Republican incumbents, congressional incumbents, to sustain campaigns because they don't have that pot of gold helping to support their cause. So I do think it's going to be a tough cycle for them. Obviously, they're not going to lose every seat. I wouldn't predict that. But I do think it's a tough cycle. There are a number of those seats, the Garcia seat, the Valdeo seat. These are marginal seats. They're very tiny. And just simply the ebb and flow of turnout between midterms and presidential elections could be sufficient to displace them.
Give everybody a few more moments here to type in any questions. So while we wait, just a reminder to everyone, we'll send around a press release following this. It'll have a recording to this briefing. It will include the poll deck that Gary went over, and also a link to the Hispanic Electorate Data Hub. There's currently a link to that in the chat box if anybody's interested immediately. Okay, if we don't have any further questions, we'll finish up here. If you do think of anything, please feel free to reach out to us. And we will be doing some more of these polls in 2024, running up to the presidential elections. So please keep your eyes peeled. Oh, we have one question from Stella. Stella, I am going to unmute you here.
Hi, sorry, I'm a slow typer, so I did not type in my question in time. I put it in the Q&A chat also. I was wondering if you could expand on the U.S. Senate candidate poll that didn't include Eric Early as an option. I was wondering, you know, since he's racking up all the or some of the local GOP endorsements, you know, why was he not included as a candidate on, you know, in the poll? And also, why do you think Garvey is pulling that high despite, you know, the appearance that he's not doing much, on, you know, ground activity right now? So that's my question. Thank you.
Yeah, I don't really have a good answer to the Early thing. I think when we wrote the questionnaire, it was at an earlier stage of the qualification process. So he might have been left out for that reason. And so my apologies on that. I would say that his name recognition is extraordinarily low and Garvey's name recognition is higher. So the reason that Garvey is doing better than you would expect a candidate who's not doing anything is that a huge percentage of the California electorate knows who he is. Not with respect to politics, but with respect to baseball. So name recognition has always been an advantage that we in political science, we refer to them as actors, athletes, and astronauts. And celebrity candidates always have that advantage. But I apologize that Early is excluded. I think when we wrote the poll, he was not a factor.
Okay, I think that is the end of questions right now. Again, please feel free to reach out if anything comes up in the meantime and keep your eyes peeled in 2024 for some more of these polls. Thanks everybody for joining us today. Have a great weekend.